Yeah, I mean, kind of looking at it, it seems like I get what you're saying, like the Valley and what Elvis was able to do with rock and roll. I can understand it's like a potential of history repeating itself. But did you, when you look at M, though, did you believe his intentions coming in was to do that, or was it the powers? Like, who were the powers that be that you felt like was trying to possibly switch that?
Yeah, well, you know, I never really got to know Eminem. I only met him really one time. I seen him twice. The second time, it wasn't much conversation. The first time, you know, it wasn't either. I just saw him backstage and said, what up? But we didn't really talk. That was before everything had started. So I don't really know him personally. And, you know, like, I don't know that was Elvis' intent. You know, gotcha. I think it's the music industry. And, you know, I mean, the music industry has been run by a small handful of, you know, international corporations for many, many years, you know, have monopolized the music industry pretty much still to this day. So, you know, music is one of the most influential things in the world. You know, music can influence the way the people think. You know, it touches your heart, your mind in a way that not too many other things can. You know, I think that the powers that be, first of all, you know, back in the 90s, realized that hip hop was becoming this social and political movement that was going to be revolutionary. And that's when, you know, they decided, you know, that Pac had to go.
Right.
You know, I believe, you know, there was much more to the story than what we've heard over the years about Tupac's murder. You know, you just look at the history of government and law enforcement, FBI involvement in all, you know, forms of Black empowerment and Black power movements, of course, going back to the 60s and, you know, the way they killed off all the Black leaders and infiltrated them and created these beefs. You know, I believe that there was a lot of that, and there still is a lot of that going on in hip hop. So I think it starts more back then, and then, you know, they're looking for a white artist that can help further, you know, kind of change the trajectory of hip hop. And, you know, as far as Eminem goes, I mean, the facts are that, you know, after things got started, you know, we did get these songs, these tapes of these songs that he had made. And, you know, we didn't go out looking for them. Some guys from Detroit that grew up with him and worked with him brought the music to us. And, you know, he made this racist rap hour, you know, tape. And, you know, he called Black people the N-word and Black women are bitches and other racial slurs. And this was it was him and three other white guys. They had a four-man rap group called Basement Productions. And you know, I don't know if he changed over the years, you know, personally, you know, but to say those kind of things and make songs about that kind of things, I mean, you definitely have a racist, you know, mentality to do that. Now, can you change? Yeah, I believe we can all change. So, I don't know what happened in the years that follow, but, you know, that's still something that's a fact.
I got you. And I also kind of believe, like, I mean, if we look back our lives, we may not be racist, but we can look at some things that we done younger. Because what they say, like, the science behind a human brain, a male brain, don't fully mature until about 25.
Sure.
So, like, behind in you, we are different people sometimes. Some people remain the same.
Yeah.
But, I mean, definitely should be held accountable for what he said, but also, you know, you give them people, I feel like we also got to give each other the grace and the space to learn, especially when you're a child.